Have you ever had a day that went from bad to worse? This morning, we're going to look at a story in 1 Samuel chapter 30, and we're looking at a man named David, a well-known character in the Old Testament, and I'll call this message David's Worst Day. We're going to look at a day that went from bad to worse. Now, just for some context, at this point in David's life, he's on the run from a murderous king named Saul. He's a fugitive. He's hiding in caves, he's living off the land, and he has a group of men that are faithful to him. So things aren't going great, and David and his men are about 50 to 75 miles away from where they're living with their families at that time. And while they're away from home, the Amalekites, these ancient enemies of Israel, come and they attack the town, the city called Ziklag, where they're living. And I want you to see this passage in 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 1. This is what happened. It said, "And when David and his men came to the city, they found it burned with fire, and their wives and sons and daughters taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him raised their voices and wept until they had no more strength to weep." Have you ever been there? Weeping till you have no more strength to weep. It's a bad day, but it's about to get worse. In verse 6, it says, "David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because all of the people were bitter in soul, each for his sons and daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord." David's worst day. Look at what happens. He loses his entire family. His closest friends lose their families to one of their worst enemies. And then, when you thought this day couldn't get any worse, those who are closest to him turn on him, and they want to blame him. They want to stone him. They want to kill him for what has happened. And then there's that little sentence at the end of the passage that we read, and it simply says, "But David strengthened himself in the Lord." I remember reading that text for the first time, and I couldn't get past that sentence. You know what I want? I want more details. What did that look like? How do you strengthen yourself in the Lord on the worst day of your life? Some of you know what the worst day of your life was. You can point to a moment where you lost someone that you loved, or you got a diagnosis, or something was done to you, or you did something to someone else. And the truth is I don't want to be pessimistic, but all of us have days in our future that are going to be difficult. And the question I hope that we can work through together this morning is simply this: how do we strengthen ourselves in the Lord on the worst day of our lives? I want to give you three simple thoughts that I think we find in this text on how we can do this. And the first thing is this: you got to start now, not then. Start now, not then. There's a saying that people often use: practice makes perfect. You heard it before? Anybody have a well-meaning parent or coach or teacher ever say to you, or a music instructor, practice makes perfect? Can I just say, I don't agree. I don't agree. And the reason I don't agree is because I've been to a lot of school band concerts. And there's been a lot of practice, and it ain't perfect, is it? And I've practiced at things very hard, and I'm not perfect at it. I don't actually believe that practice makes perfect. My wife and I, Erin, we have three little girls. Well, I say they're little, they're getting older. I've been preaching at Calvary as a guest speaker for probably about 8 years now. So many of you have been on this journey of life with my family. And our oldest daughter, Lilia, is 12, and she's going to middle school this fall. So you know how to pray for me. We have Lilia, who's 12, Caroline, who's 9, and Madeline, who is 6. And, you know, they all have different things that they like to do. And Lilia's gotten into lacrosse. I know lacrosse is a big thing in upstate New York. I know it's big in Rochester also. And in lacrosse, one of the things that the girls are learning to do at her age is learning how to use both of their hands equally well, their dominant hand and their non-dominant hand. And I practiced in the backyard during quarantine because we had nothing else to do. So we practiced every single day on her learning to use her left hand. And just this past week, she was at a tryout with a club in Syracuse for lacrosse, and I was watching her from the sidelines, and I saw her do it. She switched from her right hand to her left hand, and I was like, thank you, Jesus. Like, exactly, like, this is the practice that we've been putting in, and now it's paying off. My 9-year-old, during quarantine, we had to find something for her to do, so we got a little guitar for her, and she's been learning guitar, and I see she's practicing, and she's getting quicker now at moving her fingers and changing her chords. Then our 6-year-old Madeline, who has cerebral palsy, any time that she can do something with her right hand, it's a big deal because she has to work so hard to use her right hand. And so I believe in practice, but I don't think practice makes things perfect. What I think is practice makes things possible. Practice makes things possible. And if you're going to be able to strengthen yourself in the Lord on the worst day of your life, you have to start now, not then. If you wait, it's too late. You can't draw life and strength from roots that haven't already grown deep. You can't stand strong on a foundation that doesn't exist. And you can't flex spiritual muscles that you haven't developed. Start now, not then. And listen, sometimes we see our worst days coming, right? Sometimes we don't. 2017, I had two of the worst days in my entire life, burying my father, and then 8 months later, my little brother. Now, my father, we saw that one coming. He was diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. And although it went quick, a couple months, we had time. We had time to prepare ourselves for what that day would feel like and what that moment would be like. But with my brother, it was one phone call and he was gone. So we don't have time, do we, always, to prepare ourselves. How many of us were prepared for what we've walked through this year as a country, what your city is walking through today? We have to start now, not then. And one of the great things about David, and the reason why I think he was able to strengthen himself in the Lord in 1 Samuel 30, is that he had a habit of doing so. We know so much about his life, but we know that David, even when he was a nobody shepherd boy out in the fields, he made a practice of being in the presence of God and reminding himself of the truth of God's word. And even when he was gaining victory over the bear and the lion and those that would attack the sheep, he knew it was the Lord who was giving him strength. And then when he went to fight Goliath, he didn't say, "I come in my own strength." He wasn't reminding himself of his own strength. He was reminding himself of God's strength. "I come in the name of the Lord and in the strength of the Lord." And then when he went through terrible times running for his life, he would remind himself of the truth of who God was. So he had established this rhythm, this pattern, this habit of doing so. And we know that he did because we have some of those songs that he wrote. In fact, Psalm 57, I want to just read to you three verses from Psalm 57. David here is hiding in a cave for his life, being chased by a murderous, demon-oppressed king named Saul. And this is what David says to his own heart in prayer. "Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me, for in you my soul takes refuge. In the shadow of your wings I will take refuge till the storms of destruction pass by. I cry out to God Most High, to God who fulfills his purposes for me. He will send from heaven and save me. He will put to shame him who tramples on me. God will send out his steadfast love and his faithfulness." Now, we don't know exactly what David said to himself on that day in 1 Samuel chapter 30 to strengthen himself in the Lord, but I think it might have sounded a little bit like this. And he was able to do it on his worst day because he already knew these truths by heart. Who you are now will determine who you are then. Start now, not then. So a couple quick questions to ask yourselves before we move to the next point. What are your habits? What are the truths that you speak to your own heart? How do you strengthen yourself now? How do you comfort yourself? How do you bring rest and joy into your life? Where does your hope lie in good times, even in the best of times? Can you sense your need for Jesus even when things are going okay? Before things get bad, do you look to him more than anything else? And can you turn away from anything else and anything less ultimately can't do for you on the worst day of your life what God can do. So start now, not then. The second thing here that I want to share with you this morning is that we have to look in here, not out there. Look in here, not out there. What makes for a bad day? What makes it the worst day of your life? And if you listen to people talk about bad days, it's always about things out there, isn't it? Someone cut me off in traffic. My boss was mean to me. That person didn't talk to me. It's always out there. At the church that I pastor at, just outside of Syracuse in Clay, we have a bunch of little babies right now. In about a 4-month period, 7 moms are having babies. It's a fun time. And newborns are great, but if I can just be honest with you as a dad, the newborn stage is not my favorite stage. It just, they just lie there. You know, I mean, they don't really do much for you. It's, as a dad, it's not super rewarding. It's not super engaging. I mean, basically, they're boring. And you kind of want them to be boring because as soon as things aren't boring, that means things are bad with newborns. So boring is okay, but that's the ceiling, right? And so they're not that exciting. And there's basically 4 things that newborns do. They cry, they sleep, they eat, and they poop, right? That's like the entirety of their existence. Human beings are always doing 4 things in any given moment. And I want us to look in here because this is going to give us some clues this morning as to why we have bad days. And the four things that human beings are always doing at any given moment are observing, interpreting, worshiping, and responding. And if you're watching online, it's right across the bottom of the screen for you. Observing, interpreting, worshiping, and responding. Now, observing is just what you see, what you notice, right? But interpreting is the story or the narrative that you attach to what you just saw. Worshiping is simply that every single one of us at every moment of our lives trusts in, hopes in, and adores something more than everything else. That's whatever you worship. And then responding is our behavior. And we're always doing this. Let me give you some examples to try to make sense of this. If you're in school and somebody walks by you without saying hi to you and seems to ignore you, you've just observed something. You saw that person, didn't say hi to me. But what story do you start to tell yourself about why he or she didn't say hi to you? And whatever story you start telling yourself is informed by whatever, whoever you worship most. So if you worship approval and acceptance most, and you observe somebody walking by you without saying hi to you, what's the story that you put together? That person doesn't like me anymore. They don't talk to me. They're not accepting me. And if they don't accept me, then what am I going to do? And your life begins to spiral out of control in that moment. And then you go home and you say, I had a bad day, right? How about if someone cuts you off in traffic? Isn't it funny how in traffic, I'll just speak for myself, when I cut somebody off in traffic, it's always on accident. So, you know, I pull in front of somebody and they're angry behind me and they're honking, and I'm always like, it was just relax, just chill out. But if somebody cuts me off in traffic, it's never an accident. It's always on purpose. It's an intentional affront to my personhood, and I get really upset and really angry. What I've observed is somebody has cut me off, but the story I'm telling myself is they don't respect me. And they don't care about me. And now if what I worship is being respected, then all of a sudden, I'm having a bad day. And these are just a few examples. Let me give you one that's actually somewhat relevant to our country today. What about when you post something on social media and someone disagrees with you? Or someone posts something that you disagree with? You observe it, you tell yourself a story, that person's an idiot. They don't know what they're talking about. If they would just read this article, they would agree with me. If they just were more intelligent, if they just went to this school, if they just had this education, if they just lived. And we immediately start categorizing, characterizing, and demonizing people because what our heart loves most often is being right or the power and influence that we get from being right. Now listen, this fall, somebody is gonna get elected president of our country. We're all gonna observe the exact same thing, but we're all gonna tell ourselves different stories, aren't we? And what you worship will determine how much power that event has over your emotions, your well-being, your sense of self. You see how this works? And here's the crazy thing. It's intuitive and it's instantaneous. It's instinctive. It happens immediately. You can't stop yourself from doing these four things. You're observing, interpreting, worshiping, and responding. Understanding the connection between observing and interpreting can make you a self-aware, emotionally intelligent, mature person, but understanding the role of worshiping is what makes you able to identify the real reason you have a bad day and change. Summarize, you see something, read something, watch something, you begin to believe a story that threatens what your heart most values, something you worship, and your emotions and your response is ugly. There's a wildly popular musical on Disney Plus right now called Hamilton, and I watched it not too long ago and found it to be brilliant. And it tells a story of two historical political figures, Alexander Hamilton and Aaron Burr, who in many ways were, at least according to this telling of the story, political rivals. And towards the end of his life, this character, Aaron Burr, is looking back at every moment in his life when things didn't go the way he wanted them to go. And he sees that at every single turn, it's Alexander Hamilton who stood in his way, who blocked him from getting what he wants. And there's a great song of many great songs in this play where Aaron Burr says, I wanna be in the room where it happens. And it becomes this theme throughout the whole play that Aaron Burr's whole life is about getting inside this theoretical, hypothetical, or maybe an actual room where things are happening that he feels like he's on the outside of. And towards the end, it so consumes him that it leads him to do something quite terrible towards the end of the play, because he feels like Hamilton has blocked him his whole life from getting the one thing his heart wants most, which is to be in the room where it happens. And I thought to myself, why would someone want to be in the room where it happens? And I wrote down some things. Some of us just want to be accepted. We just want to know that we're allowed in. Some people, they don't need to make the decision. They just want their voice to be heard. Other people, it's not so much what happens in the room. They just want to be in the room so that they feel like they're better than the people who aren't in the room. Some people want control, influence. They want to be seen as an insider. They want the respect of those on the inside, and they want to feel better than those on the outside. And here's what happens in our lives. We don't just want to be in the room where it happens. We end up worshiping the room where it happens. It's one thing to want something, and it's another thing to worship something. And when you worship something, it has power over your life. Aaron Burr, he can't imagine a life worth living if he isn't going to be in the room where it happens. And here's what I'm trying to say to you this morning, and I hope it's making sense. We have to look at our hearts and understand that the way we respond to everything we observe is based on how we interpret it, but most foundational, it's based on who or what you worship. Who or what you worship will always determine how you live. And if you worship power and control, and the wrong person gets elected this fall, your life will spiral out of control. And if you worship achievement and accomplishment, and the other person gets the raise or the position at work, you'll lose your joy. And if you worship security and your bank account has taken a hit during COVID, you're having a hard time living life in a stable way, right? So, doesn't mean, of course, that these bad things don't continue to happen. It just means that we have to pay attention to who or what we love most. We give ourselves for whatever we love most, but the question we have to ask ourselves is this: can what you love most save you? What happens when you lose what you love most? What can it do for you then? Apart from Jesus, our bad days, our worst days, have the power to define us and destroy us and bring the worst out in us. That's what happened in this story. These men who were faithful to David, all of a sudden, because it was the worst day of their lives also, they wanted to destroy things. They wanted to kill things. They were looking for anything and anyone to blame, and they turned on David. Apart from Jesus, our worst days can define us and destroy us. And if we love and worship Jesus most, we still will have bad days. Don't let any preacher anywhere tell you otherwise. We're still going to have bad days. Jesus himself said, in this world, you will have troubles, right? We're going to have bad days, but we'll be able to strengthen ourselves on those days, knowing that the one in which we trust, the one in which we hope, his love for us has not been lost, and what he did for us is enough. So number one, start now, not then. Number two, look in here, not out there. And then lastly this morning, as I start to close, I couldn't think of a clever way to say this, so I'm going to say it as clear as I can. Hope in Jesus, not yourself. Hope in the Lord, not in yourself. On our worst day, on our bad days, everybody turns to something. Everybody looks to something to comfort them and to help them out. But what makes bad days worse days is when the thing that you turn to is the thing that is gone. And that's what happens. We put our trust in power and we lose it, and then where do we go? We put our trust in the health of our children and they don't have it, and then where do we turn? We put our trust into pleasure and it evades us, and then what do we do? How do we hope in those? How do we find life in those things? And the truth is we don't. We hope in Jesus, not ourselves. And let me finish this story for you in 1 Samuel chapter 30. David goes to the man of God, Abiathar, a priest, and they use this thing called an ephod to get a word from God. And what I love about this, and you need to hear this this morning, is that David doesn't run around looking for truth and hope everywhere else. He goes right to looking to the word of God. What truth does God have to say to my heart? And Abiathar says to David, David, take your men, pursue the Amalekites, and you will destroy them, and you'll get it. And that's what happens. They pursue the Amalekites, they catch them, they destroy them in battle, and they get all their children and their wives back. And it's really kind of a happy ending here. But what I want us to notice is that David doesn't for a moment trust in his own strength. He doesn't say, guys, come on, we got this, let's go get him. First, he turns to God and says, God, what do you want us to do? Even on his worst day, God, our hope is in you, not in ourselves. And I want to bring you back just to one of the verses that I read earlier from Psalm 57. And this verse is so helpful in helping us understand where do we turn on the worst day of our lives. 57 verse 2, David said, I cry out to God Most High, to God who fulfills his purpose for me. Some of you here this morning, you need the second half of that verse. You need to hear it. God will fulfill every purpose that he has for you. We need to see God for who he is. Let's break this verse down a phrase at a time and then we'll finish. He says, I cry out. You know what's so powerful about that phrase, I cry out? It simply means this, that there's a God who hears us. He's gracious. And the God is gracious, you don't have to earn anything. I cry out to the God Most High. That means exactly what it sounds like. The God is greater than anything else. And if God is great, I don't have to be in control. I can trust him. He's the God who fulfills. And what this means is that God is good. You can trust his plans. You can trust his promises. The things that he's spoken to you, he will cause them to come to pass. And then the verse ends with this phrase, his purposes for me. God has purposes for every single one of us. We sang it this morning in one of the newer songs. If we're still here, if I'm not dead, then you're not done. There's a work that you have for us to do. So God is glorious. So let me just give you those four words, they're easy to remember because they all start with the letter G. God is great. God is glorious. God is good, and God is gracious. And if you can tap into those four truths of the characteristic of God on the worst day of your life, you know what you'll be able to do? You'll be able to strengthen yourself in the Lord. And I have literally walked into some of the darkest moments of my life saying those four truths to myself in my mind. God, you're great. I don't have to be in control. Some of you will find so much rest and not always having to be in control. God, you're great, I don't have to be in control. God, you are glorious. I don't have to fear what others think of me because I know that you love me. God, you're good, I don't have to look everywhere else for goodness. All the goodness my heart craves is found in you, is satisfied in you and you alone. And God, you're gracious. So I don't have to earn anything. Listen, Christian, this morning, if you're here and you're a follower of Jesus, we have a great work to do, don't we? We have a great mission. There is a lot to do, but there's nothing to prove. Say that to your own heart this morning. I have a lot to do, but nothing to prove. Because God is gracious. He's great, he's glorious, he's good, and he's gracious. Where do you find hope on the worst day of your life? We look up to God. And David did this in verse 3. He says this simple phrase, God will send from heaven and he will save me. Now listen, David couldn't have possibly understood what that phrase would mean to us sitting here this morning. David could not have possibly understood that someday God would not just send help from heaven, but he would send his son, Jesus Christ, the God-man, come from heaven to save us. And not only would he not put us to shame, but he would take our shame in our place. And not only would he not allow us to be trampled, he would be trampled in our place so that God would pour out his steadfast love and his faithfulness on us, on those who believe, on those who trust, on those who place their hope fully and solely in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Start now. Some of you need to go home and think about your spiritual habits. What am I doing now to prepare myself for that day? Start now, not then. Look in here, look in your heart. Who or what do you love most and how is it affecting your emotions? Don't always look out there and blame circumstances and others. And then hope in Jesus, never in yourself and never in anything other than Jesus Christ. And if you do that, then here's what happens. God gives us a way forward, even on the worst day. No, especially on the worst day of our lives. Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank you this morning that you endured the worst day of your life, the cross, so that we would have a way through ours. And our hope this morning for our families, for ourselves, for our city, for our country, and for our world, it is not found in a man, it is not found in a woman, it is not found in a policy, it is not found in a program, it's not found in a way of life, it's not found in a personal conviction, it's not found in a political party, it's not found in any of those things, but it's found in Jesus and in Jesus Christ alone. And so we lift our eyes this morning to you and we say, he will send from heaven to save me. Jesus, we thank you for your work, saving us, rescuing us, and making all things new. We trust and hope in you. Friends, let's stand together this morning and respond in this song, singing the truth that even when we can't see what God's doing, he's faithfully at work.